Good morning, children. So, as you all know that we are discussing chapter number 2 of History, New Kings and Kingdoms. In this chapter till now we have discussed about the different dynasties, the emergence or the existence of new dynasties in Indian subcontinent, as well as we have seen that how the administration in all those kingdoms were done by the different kings, Maharaja, Dhiraj, Tribhuvartan, Chakravartin, all these things we have seen, as well as we have discussed about the prashastis and land grants. The prashastis or the land grants were a kind of the prashastis means the in praise of. The meaning of prashasti means what? In praise of, means praising somebody. Like in this kind of metal plates or copper plates, the kings were recording whatever the grants, land grants they have given to different people. It was recorded on such kind of copper plates. So these all the things we have discussed. Then we have discussed about the warfare for wealth. In this point we have discussed about the Kannauj region. In for gaining the control over the Kannauj region, different rulers from different dynasties have fought for several years. They struggled for several years, like Rashtrakutas, Palas and the Gurjara Pratihara. These three dynasties have fought continuously. These are all the things we have discussed. In the last period, we have started to discuss about the closer look to Cholas. In this, we have seen how the Cholas have raised their power from Uraiyar to Thanjavur in the Tamil Nadu. Then we have discussed about the splendid temples and bronze sculptures. In this point, we have seen that around these temples, the marketplace as well as various kind of things were sold, as these temples were not only the place of worship, but it was also become the socially, economically and politically important point. So as this has become the nuclei of the city, as it became so much of importance, craft persons, merchants, all the people were making their crafts and selling here near around these temples. Even the settlements have also established around such kind of temples. So these are all the things we have seen, as well as we have discussed about how the statues were made by the craft persons. After that we have discussed about the agriculture and irrigation. Today we are going to discuss the last point of the chapter, that is the administration of the empire. In this point we are going to see that how the Chola kingdom or the Chola empire was administered by the king in the different way. So in this point we are going to see that. So the first question arises that how was the administration organized? In what kind of manner the administration was organized? So settlements of peasants known as Ur. Ur means what? Peasants, settlements. All the settlements of the peasants, and you know very well who are the peasants? Peasants are the small farmers or the labor working to the fields. So they are called as the Ur. They become so prosperous with the spread of irrigation and agriculture. As the irrigation and agriculture started to develop, the prosperity of the peasants or Ur started to take place in the Chola dynasty's empire. Such villages formed larger called Nadu. Here the meaning of Nadu means what? Nadu means the land. The meaning of Nadu means what? The land. So groups of such villages form larger units and these units were called as the Nadu. Then the village council and the Nadu had several administrative functions, including dispensing justice and collecting taxes. So here it is said that when the Nadus were established, in all those Nadus, village council and Nadu had several administrative works to do, and it was including dispensing justice, means giving justice or doing the work of giving justice to the people, as well as they were collecting the taxes and revenues also. So what was the work of the Nadu to Nadu and village councils? To collect the taxes, to give the dispense the justice, as well as various kind of administrative works they were doing. Rich peasants of the Vellala caste. Vellala was the name of the caste, and these Vellala caste exercised considerable control over the affairs of Nadu under supervision of the central Chola government. So whatever the rich or powerful peasants were there, who were belonging to the Vellala caste, they were practicing the considerable control over the various kind of affairs or works related to the Nadu, under whose supervision? Under the supervision of the Chola government. The Chola kings were giving some rich landowners titles, different kind of titles. These were Muvendavelan or a peasant serving three kings. The Velan means what? The Velan means a kind of a peasant who is serving to the three kings. Then another title was also there, that was Arayar. What is Arayar? Arayar, the meaning of Arayar is chief. As markers of respect, these all kind of the titles were the markers of respect. For example, nowadays we call some people by different names and their surnames are there. So earlier, whatever the surnames were there, the surnames were the kind of the degree of respect was given to the people. So in that time, in the Chola dynasty also, various people were getting such kind of titles like Muvendavelan, Arayar, and these were all the markers of respect, and entrusted them with important offices of the state at the center. So in this way, the different kind of the administration in the Chola Empire was completely organized. Here one important thing is given, that is the types of land. In the Chola inscription, you know very well what is inscription. Inscription is a script written on the hard surface like stone or metal. So on the Chola inscription, several categories of land is mentioned. So the first category is Villanvagai. Villanvagai means what? Land of non-Brahman peasant proprietors. That means the land which belongs to the non-Brahman peasant. And the second category of the land is what? Brahmadeya. The land which is gifted to the Brahmanas is called as the Brahmadeya. Brahmadeya is the land which is gifted by the king to the Brahmanas. The next category of the land is there, that is Shalabhoga. Shalabhoga, land for the maintenance of the school. The king, the land which was given by the kings of the Chola dynasty or the dynasty, which be given for the making of school buildings and school places and all that. And which is gifted for the construction of the temples as well as the entire land that was under the control of the temple was called as the Devadana or Tirunamathukunni. In this way, last category of the land is also there, that is Pallichandan, land donated to Jaina institution. Here it is said the Pallichandam is the land which is donated to the Jaina institution. We are going to see further this different kind of land and all that. Let's try to understand the first part of it. We have seen that Brahmanas often received land grants or Brahmadeya. As we have seen here, the meaning of Brahmadeya means what? The land which is given to the Brahmanas. So the Brahmins were receiving various kind of grants and Brahmadeya. As a result, large number of Brahmana settlements emerge in the Kaveri valleys as in other parts of the South India. So as the huge land was given to in the form of the settlements of Brahmana emerge in the Kaveri valley in the southern part. Each Brahmadeya was looked after the assembly of assembly means the Sabha means what? The kind of an assembly of prominent of the landholders. These assemblies worked very efficiently. They were keeping all kind of records, activities going on those lands which were gifted to the Brahmana, and this assembly's decision were recorded daily in the form of inscriptions, often on stone or on the wall of temples. Association of traders known as Nagarams also occasionally performed administrative. So there were some associations of the also, and this association of traders called as the Nagaram. So Nagarams also occasionally performed administrative functions in the towns also. What is Nagaram? The Nagaram is the association of traders. So in this way, inscriptions from Uttaramerur in Chingleput district, Tamil Nadu, provide details of the way in which the Sabha was organized. So in Uttaramerur in Chingleput district of the Tamil Nadu, one inscription is found. In that, all kind of information that is received by the archaeologists in this inscription about the Sabha or the assembly was the complete information was written, that how the Sabha was organized. The Sabha had separate committees to do different kind of works. What kind of works were there? Like irrigation works, the work of the garden, temples, names of those eligible to be members of these committees were written on small ticket of palm leaf and kept in an earthenware pot, from which a young boy was asked to pick the ticket one by one for each committee. You know, as you all play the fish pond, you put different chits in that small pot, and then somebody comes and picks that that chit, and then you get to know something. In the same way, the draw system was there for how the different committees were given the different kind of works. So on a small ticket of the palm leaf, the eligible candidates' names were written, and all these leaves or all these tickets were kept into the earthenware pot, which is called like matka or something like that. And one young boy was asked to pick the ticket, and then one by one each committee was coming to present their work, or they were given the work. So in this way, all these things are explained in this chapter. Several important things are there which is yet to explain. In the next period, we will see the small details of this chapter, and then we will finish the chapter with the important questions and answers. Thank you very much.